paper?
Sorry, is it all right?
Sorry.
Okay, nice. Thank you. I'm an agent of service. Does anybody still have ballots back here that they want to vote on? Did y'all tell y'all voted already? Yeah? Nice.
Any more votes?
You know what? It's actually, they already exist. Well-known performers. Okay. You can just pick which one's name you like best. I mean, some people can
take the information you know. What was that?
Okay.
All right? I'll come back to you.
All right, you guys all said that.
Okay.
Okay. It's probably not going to be able to be heard.
Okay.
Grab it and repeat it.
Grab it? Okay.
Okay.
So all y'all voted, right? You mind if I ask, what did y'all vote on? Meek Mill and Drake?
Oh, okay.
Voted for Meek Mill.
Y'all voted for Meek Mill.
All y'all voted for Meek. Anybody vote for Drake?
No.
All right, we're not going to talk about this. I'm going to keep that in mind. All right.
There are more.
I have a few here. Maybe not. No, these are just things.
And someone gave me that pencil.
And empties. Okay, there's some in there. Okay, actually, I literally collected one.
All right. All right. Okay, great. Well, I got one more. Super important.
So during the Cheyenne web song, I'm gonna one of the audience members is gonna read it, and then I'm gonna come and read it again.
I'm excited.
Awesome. Hey.
I'm gonna
so wait, what was the word on?
It was happening. Wow.
Oh. Wow. Okay.
Are there any more votes in the audience today? Any more ballots out there? All right. Okay. Yeah. All right. I got you, bro.
Make sure it counts personally.
I got you.
One more, there we go.
I don't think it does it change it? No? Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, this is what we got.
Welcome to Voices of Voting. You don't vote, you don't count. Or at least that's what they say. Or someone said, or I'm saying right now. But you voted. So, you count. And we asked some pretty big questions. And the results are in.
In a blowout, vanilla takes it over chocolate. Now, does somebody over here vote for vanilla? Could you tell me why, please? Because she likes vanilla.
Oh, okay, good stuff.
Okay.
We are ready to make another projection. In a close election, Steph Curry was chosen the best player in the world over LeBron James.
Wow.
Voters were clear and why Steph Curry is the man. Who voted for Steph Curry?
Oh, wait a minute. Hang on.
Could you share your opinion, please? Yes.
All right. In another contest, polls had Meek Mill ahead versus Drake. But Drake pulled it out in the end. Wow. What city are we in? I got to talk to somebody who voted. You voted for Drake, correct? What has you so hype about Drake?
I like his music. We like his songs and music. All right.
Okay.
I like that song too.
Final ballot. Jay-Z.
Okay.
Or Beyonce.
Okay. Before you can vote or even be eligible to answer my friend Jazeer's question, could you please explain this sentence to me? The income arising from the 16th Section Trust Fund, the Surplus Revenue Fund, until it's called for by the United States Government, and the funds enumerated in Sections 257 and 258 of this Constitution, together with a special annual tax of 36 on each $100 of taxable property in this state, which the legislature shall levy, shall be applied to the support and maintenance of public schools. And it shall be the duty of the legislation to increase the public school fund from time to time as a necessity. Therefore, the conditions of the Treasury and the resources of the state may justify. So, what did all that mean? Huh? Okay. We're excited about it. Can you tell me what all that meant? Oh, not quite. No vote for you. You did try. You know? You want me to repeat it? I'm going to do it one more time. The income arising from the 16th Section Trust Fund, the Surplus Revenue Fund, until it's called for by the United States Government, you must know by now. Come on. Too slow. Okay, no vote for you.
What?
Oh.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right there.
You've got to know.
All right, can you explain that sentence for me?
Something about the Constitution?
No, no vote for you, I'm sorry.
Who thinks that was easy? Who thinks that was fair? Who thinks that could ever happen to someone if they were trying to vote?
Okay, let me ask you this. Who knows how to fix my car?
Not now, man.
We gotta get this thing fixed, Cleo.
Yeah, but, let me interrupt here. We've gone back 50 plus years. Now, this is Cleophas Hobbs, Cleo, and this is Charles Bonner, Chuck. Now, we're here to talk about voting and the right to vote. So, all that crazy stuff he asked you to explain not only could happen, but did happen. How did it change? Well, these two, a couple of teenagers, are a great place to start. We're in Selma, Alabama, February 1963.
And my car has broken down. Beautiful 1954 Ford.
Your mother's car.
I have custody.
Now how come you don't act like it? Does not know how to take care of that thing.
And if
you
I did, we never would have been a part of it all.
This actually happened.
See, we're pushing my car up the street
to car.
My house Sunday morning, and this guy offers to help us. Nicely dressed, bow tie.
Name's Lafayette.
And he starts talking to us about why he's in Selma.
To get Negroes the right to vote. Out of 15,000 eligible Negroes, only 130 are registered. But more than 100% of eligible white voters are registered.
Now, wait. I'm not the best math student at Hudson High. But how do you come up with more than 100%?
And if you're a Negro and want to register, you have to show that you have a sixth grade education.
Which not many do.
And can read.
Which a lot of people can't.
And can answer all types of questions on what they call a literacy test.
The funds enumerated from sections 257 and 258 of this constitution divided by the government is...
Which is designed to confuse you and catch you up. And if you're white...
You guessed it.
You don't have to do any of that. I want to change all that and I want you two to help.
You want... us involved.
And the more he starts to talk, the more we start to get riled up. I mean, ever since I was a little kid out in the country, I couldn't understand why we were living in a weather-beaten house and the man whose cotton we picked was living in a big white mansion. I couldn't understand why the white kids had better school buses. They had better books than we did. And I couldn't understand why we were segregated. Why I went to a little one-room school with a potbelly stove in the back of my church, whereas the white kids went to a brick school building with a manicured lawn.
And now we sure can't understand how if this is a democracy...
And slavery ended 100 years ago.
And this is the land of the free, how come our people don't have the right to vote? Don't have the right to be heard, don't have any say over our lives.
Lafayette tells us even the civil rights leaders have given up on Selma.
It's poor!
Negroes have no power, and people say no change could ever happen.
But we are totally primed to take action.
Selma, Alabama, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, or SNCC, has a legion of new activists, high school students mobilizing for civil rights.
By the time the adults got to Selma, Selma had already been organized by the kids.
This is our classmate, Betty Mae Fikes.
I didn't have a clue of what was going on in the adult world around me. I just thought joining the movement might be a fun way to get out the house. You know, keep from going to church. But it got hard, nasty even. And joining the movement gave me the new idea that I could do anything.
Birmingham, Alabama. 1,000 school students protesting for civil rights are met with police dogs and fire hoses. Over 900 land in jail.
We didn't have a clue we were making history. We were just trying to make some wrongs right.
Washington, D.C. Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech to a crowd of over 200,000 caps the march on Washington.
And 2 weeks later, on a Sunday morning in Birmingham, Alabama, four little girls are killed in the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church.
In the weeks after the bombing, 200 kids are arrested in protest.
The movement is on.
Freedom Day.
October 7th, 1963.
More than 350 adults show up at the courthouse in Selma to register to vote.
Go out and support the kids.
And they do.
Standing in the sun for 8 hours.
You can't leave to eat, you cannot return. You can't leave to get a drink. You cannot return.
Selma Sheriff Jim Clark.
Hey, if you need to go to the bathroom, you cannot return.
But he can't tell you when to use
the bathroom. If anyone talks to those in line, they'll be considered to be molesting them and will be arrested.
We have a right to stand here and
your civil rights be damned.
One man, one vote.
Move on.
One man, one vote.
Move on.
One man, one vote.
Move on.
One man, one vote.
Thank you.
4:30 p.m. The courthouse closes. No one is registered, but...
Jim Clark never thought we could get that many people to register.
Mm-hmm. Big Jim was shuffling today like we used to.
This is the day when a century of fear and terror was not able to stop the forward thrust of a people determined by any means to be free.
That's John Lewis. He's still alive and active today. He's a congressman from Georgia.
He said Freedom Day was the turning point in the right to vote.
He spoke at the March on Washington, just 23.
Here's what he said.
To those who have said, be patient and wait, we must say that we cannot be patient. We do not want to be free gradually. We want to be free now.
We are tired. We are tired of being beaten by policemen. We're tired of seeing our people locked up over and over again in jail, and then you holler, be patient. How long can we be patient? We want our freedom, and we want it now.
Get in and stay in the streets of every city, of every village and hamlet of this nation until true freedom comes.
Until a revolution is complete.
We must get in this revolution and complete the revolution.
In the deltas of Mississippi, in Southwest Georgia,
in the Black Belt of Alabama, in Harlem,
in Chicago, in Detroit,
Philadelphia,
and all over this nation, the black masses are on a march for freedom. Right.
They're talking about slow down and stop.
We will not stop.
One man, one vote.
We shall splinter a segregated South into 1,000 pieces.
One man, one vote.
Put them together in the image of God and democracy.
One man, one vote. We must say, wake up, America. Wake up.
For we cannot stop, and we will not and cannot be patient.
First time, for the first time.
What shall we do for the first time?
Ooh, come here. Look. Whoa, it's Mrs. Simmons.
Cheyenne.
She's marching.
Whoa, that's ugly old Mrs. Sweetbriar.
That's Mrs. Bright.
That looks like all of them.
January 22nd, 1965, something unbelievable happens. More than 100 Selma school teachers march to the courthouse steps, demanding the right to vote. It is the first time the teachers take a stand.
They had good jobs. They didn't want to lose them. They were just quiet before all that.
This is Cheyenne Webb, 8 years old.
They had good jobs, but they followed us.
That's Mr. Huggins. Go, coach. Look, they're moving him to the front of the line.
That's because he's been lifting all them weights just like I showed him.
Leo, you never saw weight till he put it in your hand. You about fell over. He's not going to fall over.
Go, coach. Go get your freedom.
That's what they would say. They'd get up from class and leave, the 10th, 11th, and 12th graders, and go out to march for the right to vote. One of them, he says to me,
if we can't vote, then we ain't free. If you ain't free, well, then you're slaves.
And I said to him, son, you're 15. You're not old enough to vote.
Well then, coach, I guess I'm going for you. I'm going to go get your freedom.
And he walked out.
That looks like Mrs. Fulton. What's she doing out here?
Looks like she's marching.
I think she'd be too afraid to get her shoes dirty. I never figured her much for a troublemaker. That's what they'll call you, a troublemaker. They can put you in jail if just three of you get together.
How can we teach American civics if we can't vote ourselves?
I'm not talking about teaching civics. I'm talking about the law and who enforces the law. And that's Sheriff Clark, and that's his courthouse.
The Reverend Moore says it's our courthouse.
You're putting the three of us in danger.
You know Cheyenne Webb around the corner? She's 8. She marched. She got arrested. I want to do this for her, for all of us.
You were the quietest girl in high school. You were so scared to get married, you couldn't even say I do out loud. What happened?
You see that many girls and boys get beat with nightsticks and stuck with cattle prods? Pretty soon you just lose your own fear.
Well, then you better take this in case you have to spend the night.
First time.
Teachers, for the first time. We've come to register.
What shall we do?
Go back.
We've come to register. What shall we do?
Go back.
Ain't gonna let nobody turn me round.
The teachers were getting getting beaten. And Chuck stands in front of Jim Park and sings that song.
Keep on walking.
I'd ask Chuck,
keep
man, you think things are ever gonna change?
Marching to
he said to me, do you remember Mrs.
Land.
Sweetbriar asking you if you thought she should march? When was the last time a grown-up bothered asking what you think?
After the march, Mrs. Fulton came up to me. She was laughing and crying and saying how bad her feet hurt. She said, Cheyenne, how'd I do? I said, you did real good.
Who wants candy?
I do.
Okay. Let me try this in a different way. How many people think that only this section of the audience should get some candy? Okay. I have one more try. How many people in this section of the audience thinks that only this section of the audience should get some candy? That sound fair?
What if we told you that's how we choose the mayor in this city? Okay, it doesn't involve candy and bribery, but it does involve only 10% of young voters voting. That would be like all of you letting these guys over here make your decisions for you.
What if they don't think like you? What if they don't know anything about your neighborhood? What if they don't care?
Yo, bro, are you a registered voter? Excuse me.
Busy. Yes.
Well, this will only take a moment.
It doesn't concern me.
It really does.
I'm only 18, so.
Then you're eligible.
I don't do politics. It's not my thing.
Okay, well, let's see what is his thing. Snapchat? Instagram? Whoa. Text.
Can't make it. Train ran late. Nah, I gotta go to work. I got class. CCP? Community college? Doctor tomorrow. Shoulder. Car almost hit me. Traffic light broke. Cops got him. Nice. You get Made in America tics? Awesome.
Wait. You don't do politics. You don't do any of this.
Yo, give me my phone back.
Let's take a look at your day. For starters, you never left home.
Huh?
No train. Politics makes the trains run. Elected officials decide the budget. Maybe if you did politics, they'd put more money in and the trains would run on time. And you didn't go to work because you don't have a job.
No. I don't get it.
Job equals taxes. Taxes equals government. Government equals voting. Unemployed and out of school. No community college at all because...
Politics.
That's right. Government funded, government run. And I hope your shoulder heals okay.
Thanks.
Without a doctor, you've got no insurance. No politics, no voting, no Obamacare. Which is a shame because one day you will get hit. That traffic light's never getting fixed. No politics, no voting, no road care. And no police to get the guy who hit you. And sorry, but make other plans for Labor Day. No Made in America.
That's where we got you. We pay for that ourselves. No voting needed.
Except without all that voting, there's nobody to clean the streets, provide the permits, or provide security. No government? No party!
Listen, stop, wait, chill. Okay, someone's gonna get elected. Whether I vote or not. So.
And maybe they will care about your trains or your community college or your Labor Day weekend or maybe...
Cut it. Can't afford it. Made in America? Maybe not. You don't vote. You don't count.
Don't vote. Don't count.
Don't go in. They'll keep you out. Don't vote. Don't count. Don't go in. They'll keep you out. Don't vote. Don't count. Don't go in. They'll keep you out.
All right.
Speaking of counting,
who wants to vote?
I need to know, does anybody know how many stars are in this
Can you tell me jelly beans are in the jar? All right,
here you go.
You
have to count the bubbles.
Sorry, no vote for you. Anybody else want to vote today? Can you guess how many jelly beans are in the jar?
I'm going to see. What do you think?
1,500, sorry, no vote for you.
Oh, you need an exact answer, so no vote for you. That's not so
for you. Sorry, no vote for you. Yes?
No,
sorry, no vote for
That's
you.
Not gonna work either. I'm sorry.
Count the bubbles on the box.
You got it though.
How many bubbles? 900?
1.3 million?
9,000?
No, no, not quite. No vote for you. I'm sorry, bro. I'm sorry.
99.
Not today.
Now, you said three. No. No vote for you. Anybody else want to vote today?
That's not the right answer, is it?
You can't count.
Sorry,
you don't
no
count.
Vote for you?
That's how it would go in Alabama, Louisiana, or Mississippi. You couldn't count those stars, you couldn't count those jelly beans, or you couldn't count the bubbles. Too bad, you couldn't vote.
Of course, you could try another way.
A U.S. senator elected in the general election in November takes office the following year on what date?
Does enumeration affect the income tax levied on citizens in various states?
Could you repeat the...
What words are required by law to be on all coins and paper currency of the U.S.?
Anybody know the answer to this?
Oh, okay. You want to play. Who wants to try? Come on up. You ready? Divide a vertical line into two equal parts by bisecting it with a curved horizontal line that is only horizontal at a spot bisection on the vertical.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, take a seat now. It's fine. All right, all right. Okay, last question. The Bill of Rights is found within what document?
The Constitution.
That's actually a 15-mile walk because she doesn't want to drive.
Because people are talking.
Don't drive on election day.
If you're black, they'll arrest you.
Won't let you out till after the polls close. You're almost there. One of the very, very few.
Black people, that is. White, no problem. Excuse me. White and, can't read or pass that test? No problem. Turns out, if you were descended from someone eligible to vote before 1867, that's before blacks were allowed to vote, you could vote. Almost all whites were handy.
Whoa! Poll tax.
What?
You have to pay to vote. Everybody does it.
You're finally here.
The problem is, so is the sheriff and his revolver.
I don't think today is a good day for you to vote. Maybe next time, understand?
And so you go home. 15 miles.
Just got to tramp some more.
This is Cager Lee.
Just got to tramp some more.
He's 82 years old, the son of a slave.
I've been here a long time. I never voted. It's time I did. I tried to register 5 times, got turned back every time. Just got to tramp some more.
It's March 26, 1965, and he's getting close to the steps of the state capitol in Montgomery, Alabama.
He's been marching, tramping for 5 days.
My grandson, Jimmy Lee Jackson, went with me all 5 times I tried to register. He tried too. Now he's dead, killed last month by a state trooper. He had to die for something. Thank God it's this.
Just a month ago, over 200 law enforcement officers brutally attacked voting rights activists in Cager's hometown.
Cager and his grandson take refuge in a cafe.
Police attack Jimmy Lee's mom.
He tries to defend her, but a state trooper shoots Jimmy Lee point blank in his stomach.
Jimmy Lee dies a week later.
The state trooper goes free for 45 years until 2010, when he's convicted of a misdemeanor manslaughter. He's sentenced to 6 months.
Just got to tramp some more.
Sunday, March 7th, 1965.
Bloody Sunday.
That's when we started.
Jimmy Lee's murder inspires over 600 people to march from Selma to Montgomery.
We will write the voting rights law in the streets of Selma!
Chuck Bonner is there, a long way from pushing a broken down Ford.
I'm scared, Betty Mae. My feet out of sync with my heart. I'm so scared. But we have to continue.
They only get a half mile because...
On the Edmund Pettus Bridge, we see...
This is John Lewis.
A sea of blue across a 4-lane road. Troopers with Confederate flags on helmets. horses, clubs as big as baseball bats. I'm in front. My friend Jose asks.
Can you swim?
No.
Neither can I, but we may have to.
Jose says to the troopers.
I'd like to have a word.
No word to have. Troopers, advance.
Ah! I'm gonna die here.
Club swinging.
Get up.
Horses charging.
Tear gas.
Can't see. Can't breathe.
But that night, for the first time, America sees on their TVs. On the TV, they were showing the judgment at Nuremberg.
About the trial of Nazi war criminals who brutally murdered, gassed the Jews in World War II.
But now on the TV, they're showing Alabama troopers gassing our people.
Who want to vote.
And America is...
The White House, President Johnson, Dr. King. Voting rights is what matters, Mr. President. Do something you can be proud to tell your grandchildren.
I can't do it, not yet.
And after Bloody Sunday, a young activist, people really want to vote, Mr. President. We need a Voting Rights Act.
Ah!
Just got to tramp some more.
And 2 days after Bloody Sunday, there's one more march to the bridge, one more confrontation with troopers. This time, Dr. King is there. He turns the march around before there's violence.
But that night, one more murder. James Reeb, a white minister in Selma to join the protests, is attacked and killed.
And then, finally, some say, President Johnson tramps to Congress.
Wednesday, I will send to Congress a law designed to eliminate the illegal barrier to the right to vote. The command of our Constitution is plain. It is wrong, deadly wrong, to deny our fellow Americans the right to vote. What happened in Selma is part of a far larger movement that reaches into every section of America. It is the effort of American Negroes to secure for themselves the full blessings of American life. Their cause must be our cause.
John Lewis is watching from a cramped little room with other activists.
It is up to all of us to overcome the crippling legacy of bigotry and injustice.
And then I hear the President of the United States, the white Texan President of the United States, say,
"And we shall overcome."
Can you believe he said that?
So now we're almost there. The capital of Alabama, the largest voting rights march ever, 3,600 people, taking us days. 5 hard days. Could you read this for me, please?
Cheyenne Webb, 8 years, was killed today. She was one of Dr. King's freedom fighters. She was a student at Clark School of Selma. Cheyenne wanted all
Cheyenne Webb, who inspired Mrs. Fulton to action, went on the march from Selma to Montgomery.
I didn't die. I just thought I might. So I wrote my obituary and I left it for my parents. I snuck out. But when Dr. King found out, he sent me home. But I could have kept on. I felt like I was marching to heaven. Back home, they gather around and tell me about what happened.
We started with 3,600 people. Mm-hmm. We ended with 25,000. Oh. There were a bunch of maids standing in front of their motels with their carts, their bosses behind them. Mm-hmm. It was clear, you march, you're fired. Some of them just joined in anyway. They want to vote.
That racist Governor Wallace was peeking from behind them curtains.
He couldn't believe all those people were there.
Then they started telling me about what Dr. King said.
He started with, we are on the move now.
Now you try.
We are on the move now.
Yes, we are on the move, and no wave of racism can stop us.
We are on the move now.
The burning of our churches will not deter us. The bombing of our homes will not dissuade us.
We are on the move now.
The beating and killing of our clergymen and young people will not divert us.
We are on the move now.
Let us march on ballot boxes until the Wallaces of the world tremble away in silence.
And 4 months later, on August 6th, President Johnson signs the Voting Rights Act of 1965.
No procedure shall be applied by any state to deny the right of any citizen of the United States to vote on account of race or color. That means that all adults, no matter their race, are allowed to vote. No more literacy tests. Very soon, no more poll taxes. And in states with a history of voter discrimination, they have to get permission to make any changes to their voting laws. That means that Alabama, Mississippi, Georgia, and the rest can't try going back to their old ways.
Let us march on ballot boxes until we send to our city councils, state legislatures, and the United States Congress men who will not fear to do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with thy God.
Let us march on ballot boxes until all of God's children can walk the earth in decency and honor.
The battle is in our hands.
The road ahead is not altogether a smooth one.
But we must keep going.
I know some of you are asking today, how long will it take? Somebody's asking, how long will prejudice blind the visions of men?
How long? Not long, because no lie can live forever.
How long? Not long, because you shall reap what you sow.
How long? Not long, because the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice.
How long I gotta stand here?
How long is this gonna take?
How long is the line?
How long is the wait?
How long until we get it?
How long until we're fed up?
How long is too long?
When enough is enough.
Running late, just voted. That's right. I voted today. Thank you. I see that y'all don't really have a problem with that, which is good, you know, because I know what I said, and I meant it. I mean, our generation grew up hearing that the government are all crooks and don't trust them. So the first thing we're gonna do is go out and vote, right? Accept supply and demand. Know why the city puts up with all the mess and crowds that made in America? Okay, yeah, the music. But because people are willing to pay for it. They'll work for it. You know why most people are going? Okay, they're going to check out who else is there. They're going because everyone else is going. It's a thing. So, I'm at work and I'm doing the usual complaining. Minimum wage, too low. Tuition at community, too high. And this guy I work with, normally a really quiet guy, he says to me, that's because we don't show up. We don't vote for them or against them. How are the changes we want gonna happen? We don't put ourselves out there, so we got no power. Man, I hate having no power. So check it out. If the city's gonna let Jay-Z blast all that music that those old people living in the condos on the parkway just hate, because other people, young people, want it, well, then that's some power. We show up at Made in America. Made in America's a thing. If we show up to vote, our collective power grows. Let's make it a thing.
I voted in November for Clinton.
And the next election? City council? Mayor?
Look, president is what matters, right? Change starts at the top, doesn't it?
No, change starts with the math. Let's say all of you are the total number of registered voters. People signed up to vote for the last election for mayor. You eight, stand up, please. You're the youngest voting bloc. You're the largest group of eligible voters. The youngest people are the biggest bloc.
Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4. Can you four stand up, please? You are the oldest voting bloc. 65 and up. Nearly half the size is the youngest bloc. We got you beat.
Except, stay up, please. Let's make this group the number of people who actually voted. First off, it's just 25% of the people who could have voted, which is a whole other thing. But you three, stand up, please. You're the oldest voting bloc. You're half the people who voted. And you, stand up. You're the youngest voting bloc. 11% of the people who voted.
We have twice as many people who could have voted as the old people, but the old people trounce us when it comes to showing up.
So, who counts?
The 65 and up crowd, they show up. You can take your seats.
You know, I heard something that made a lot of sense. This guy, Derek Thompson, he said, if you want a revolution, you have to vote for it again and again, and not just in the presidential elections.
How long?
Not long. We have to vote again and again.
What shall we do? Go back.
Not just for cool candidates.
Just got to tramp some more.
If you want to change, if you want to matter.
Cheyenne want all the people to be free and happy.
Then you've got to vote again and again and again in local elections.
How long?
Midterm elections.
How long?
State elections.
How long?
And presidential elections.
Put your drop in the bucket.
Charles Bonner.
The promise of equality in America is not yet fulfilled. It's much better now than it was in 65, and it's something I'm totally motivated to work for, but it requires a collective effort. Look, when Cleo and I were pushing that car up the street with Mr. Lafayette, hearing about why our people were not able to vote, we didn't know what we could do. But we became a drop in the bucket in trying to combat injustice. See, each of our drops created a pond of a movement, and ultimately, a waterfall of change. It was a collective effort. Will you put your drop in the bucket?
So put your drop in the bucket.
Drop in the bucket.
Just a drop in the bucket.
Drop in the bucket.
You gotta drop for the bucket.
Drop for the bucket.
Make a waterfall of change.
Drop in the bucket.
Gotta start somewhere if it's ever gonna stop. Gotta hustle at the bottom, get it shaking at the top. Every big jump takes a skip and a hop. Every giant downpour and his first raindrop.
If you ever gonna count,
gotta start with number one.
If you're never gonna speak up,
then sister, you'll be done.
Well, another's gonna happen.
Send the father to the son. If that's what you think, pops, then they got you on a run. Be a drop in the bucket.
Drop in the bucket.
Then drop for the bucket.
Drop for the bucket.
Racking up the drops in the bucket.
Yeah. Drops in the bucket.
Make a waterfall of change.
Drops in the bucket.
Gotta tramp some more. 50 miles, 50 years. Gotta tramp some more through the blood, gas, and tears. If your heart can't feel what your feet trying to say, gotta tramp some more so you can count another day. Count the drops in the bucket.
Drops in the bucket.
Racking up the drops in the bucket.
Drops in the bucket.
Whole lot of drops in the bucket.
Drops in the bucket.
Make a waterfall of change.
Drops in the bucket.
Gotta tramp some more.
Drop in the bucket.
50 miles, 50 years.
Drop in the bucket.
Gotta tramp some more.
Drop in the bucket.
Through the blood, gas, and tears.
Drop, drop.
When your heart can't feel.
Drop in the bucket.
What your feet trying to say.
Drop in the bucket.
Gotta tramp some more.
Drop in the bucket.
So you can count another day.
Drop, 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 drop. My drop can add up to a flood. Step by step can take back a neighborhood. I sit one by one, maybe finally does some good. Vote by vote, might not take it, but good. You gotta drop for the bucket.
Drop for the bucket.
Up your drops in the bucket.
Drops in the bucket.
All the drops in the bucket.
Drops in the bucket.
On the drops in the bucket.
Drops in the bucket.
Put your ballots in the bucket.
Ballots in the bucket.
Make a waterfall of change. Drop in the bucket.
Drop in the bucket.
Thanks so much for being here. My name is David Bradley, and it's my pleasure to be the writer and director of this play, Voices of Voting, commissioned by Philadelphia's Committee of 70. It's Philadelphia's Grace Good Government Group looking out for civic participation. I want to just, first of all, let's give a big hand to Meredith Foot and everybody who goes for it. What a turnout! And so great to have folks from your school and from your
Can you just introduce yourselves?
Great. I am Anthony Martinez Briggs.
I'm Jazier Terrell.
Hi, I'm Ife Foy.
I'm Scott.
So Scott, Jordan, and Anthony are also part of a band in Philadelphia called Il Dudes, and we were so glad to be able to collaborate with them to create the music for the show. So just wanted to get a sense from you, and we've got microphones, I think, so people can talk, of a moment in the play that stuck out to you, a line or something that happened or a person, something that sticks in your mind where if somebody said, what did you see this morning? You'd say, well, there was this play and it had this thing in it. So somebody want to offer a something. You, I'll give you my microphone. It had a march about the civil rights movement. That's excellent. Remember any names of who was involved in that? No names? Look down on your shirt. Martin Luther King. Okay, he was one. Any other name who's sort of been in the news lately? John Lewis, yes. Somebody else, something that stuck with them. So a march for about the civil rights movement. We got one here.
Gotta tramp some more.
So what did that mean to you?
That meant you persist. Even when it's hard, even when it doesn't feel like it's working, you gotta tramp some more.
Thank you. Somebody else, something that stuck with you right there, and we got a microphone for you, sir.
You need to vote more than just in the presidential election.
Did everybody hear that? Say that again.
Vote every time you have a chance, not just in the presidential election.
Indeed. One of the things that was really interesting to discover in making this play was the fact that, you know, we kind of know this, but then you stop and think about it. A lot of the things that matter to us, like your school, and I heard the state senator talk about what it took to keep this school open, that happens at the local level. We love to think the federal government's going to do things, but that was the local level making a decision to keep the school open. So voting when it's just the city election isn't just the city election. It's that directly affects, for instance, this building. It was great to hear. Somebody else, something that stuck with you. Or over here, excellent. Take the mic, hold it close to your mouth.
I feel like this will provoke people to vote because what all of you guys went through will provoke people to vote.
Why do you think, just make sure, I love the word, it will provoke people to vote. I like that. So why do you think it's important? Why do you think it will provoke people to vote?
Because this is a lesson. It will teach people to vote because lots of people will do a lot of things for us to vote today.
All right. You're going to vote?
Yes, I am.
All right. How old are you? You're 13? So how many years until you can vote? Till you're 18, 4 more years. So, you might get to vote in your first election. Might get to be the presidential election. All right, watch the news. Just raise your hand here. How many of you have voted before? And how many of you who haven't voted think you'll vote when you get a chance to?
Yeah.
Excellent. Excellent. So here's what I want to ask. Why? Why would you vote? Go ahead, young man. Take the mic, hold it close to your mouth. Hold it real close to your mouth.
To prevent people like Donald Trump to be elected president.
To prevent people, you know, I'll say what he said, like Donald Trump to be elected. So you vote because you don't want somebody to get in. But let me ask you this. So that's to vote against. And that's sometimes we do that. What would you want to vote for? Why is it important to vote for? Like, what matters to you, do you think? No, you're thinking. All right, over here.
Because you get your voice heard.
And why does that matter?
Because some people's voice is never heard, so you get to speak up and get a chance to have a choice.
Nice, nice. Getting your voice heard, speaking up, and having a choice. Those are three great things. Somebody else who hasn't voted, why they would vote? Anyone? Why, Matt, where? Oh, over here. Awesome. She's going to vote next year. Why do you want to vote?
Because I want to stand up for what I think is important.
I'm signing on now to be the campaign manager. What do you think is important?
Everything in the world.
Everything in the world. Can you give me one particular thing?
Us humans.
Us humans. All right, I mean, that's hard to argue with. I want to ask the cast, is there somebody that you play that particularly spoke to you or that kind of made you think or that you learned about in a new way? One of the three of you want to answer that? Ife wants the mic.
I play John Lewis, and I've been following some things that have been said about him from Donald Trump towards John Lewis, and just learning about his story and all that he's done for civil rights since the March on Washington, when he spoke there when he was 23, up until now. Like, he's still alive and he's still working diligently to help citizens and to make America a better place for everyone. That really stood out to me. I feel very connected to him because his service is lifelong. You know, his service has been lifelong, and it seems like he doesn't, I think he's 78 right now?
Yeah, 77.
77, 78. So he's been serving people for 50 plus years, which is half a century. And to think about someone who has persevered for 50 years restlessly, relentlessly, is just so inspiring and so what we need. And it inspires me to try to do more acts of service in my life. You know, maybe I won't do 50 years, but I could do a few.
I feel particularly inspired by Cager Lee. Here's a man who's got to see both sides of the right to vote for a time. I mean, just coming from being the son of a slave to seeing when rights were completely denied, to seeing the fight for civil rights begin and really pick up. And also, he's someone who suffered considerable loss in the pursuit of something larger and didn't let the loss stop him. It's very easy when something tragic happens to us personally to be trapped by it, to get stuck, and to not see past your own pain, but to see through that to a larger goal and to keep going anyway is amazing to me.
Sure. What I'll say is Cleo was the character who I kind of most connected with because he was a young person who got involved even before the right to vote was something that was on his particular plate. You know, but it wasn't necessarily his year to vote, but he was out there alongside many other members of the youth who were out there and fighting for rights that they had not, that their parents had not yet gained, and even once they were gained, they might not have access to for several years. So to have that foresight as a young person is very inspiring to me.
That's one of the things that knocked us out working on this play is, you know, Cheyenne Webb, who's eight, or these teenagers, they were out ahead of the adults. They got involved before the adults even got involved, and like Cheyenne says, the teachers followed the students. And so to all of you guys who are here today, you young people, way to go. Because that's exactly the spirit of Chuck and Cleo and Cheyenne.
And on the Cheyenne note, when we talk about civil rights, we always talk about the heroes, right? We never talk, we rarely talk about the heroines. We rarely talk about the like black women being behind the scenes and black women and other women of color being the organizers of the actual movement, the blood and the heartbeat of the movement, you know? And to hear a story about Cheyenne Webb, who's 8 years old, you know, an 8 year old, unlike someone who's 25 or 45, if they get out there and march, you're not really thinking about losing their lives, you know? They're not really thinking about what it means to put it all on the line. And to have that youth and that courage is so inspiring because the children or the youth don't have that blockage, you know? You don't have to worry about your car or your house or your family. You just want to do what's right. And to see that goodness and to learn about that goodness in someone as young as eight who snuck out of her house and, you know, got sent home is just incredible, totally incredible.
So we have a couple minutes. If anybody has a question or a comment they want to make or something the play made them think about or a question about the material or how we put it together, we're happy to take that. Don't need to be shy, but also don't need to speak up if you don't want. Anything? All right, that's cool. I want to again say thank you to our hosts, to Meredith Foote and the Overbrook Educational Center. And I want to quickly introduce my friend David Thornburg, who is the leader of the Committee of 70, and it was their idea that this place should exist. So David.
Thank you. Thank you, David. How about a big, big round of applause for David, the wonderful actors, and Lil Deuce. So the Committee of 70 has been around for a long time here in Philadelphia, and we have a single purpose, which is to get people more involved in the political process and government. And it's a great honor to be with all of you today. But thanks to Principal Foote, it's an honor to be with you today celebrating the life of one of the great Americans, one of the great citizens of the world. And we hope that in some way this play inspires you, gives you a new sense of purpose, a new sense of commitment, because, you know, our mayor said a couple weeks ago at an event we did, this is the only democracy we have. It doesn't always work very well, but it's important to all of us that we do everything we can to make it work. So you should have a pretty good sense coming out of this about what your job is, and that begins by going into the voting booth on election day. So one of our staff, Justin Valeri, is going to be with you at lunch. He's got voting registration forms. If you are old enough to register yourself, that'd be 18, why grab one. If you want to bring one home to your parents and say, Mom, Dad, let me see what I got today. This is for you. Talk to Justin. Otherwise, thank you all so much for being out here, for your service, and we look forward to connecting with you in the future. Thank you so much.